Okay, thank you all for joining. I've been asked by Martin Clear to provide a presentation as a keynote, and I've tried to truly create a keynote presentation. So this will not be a presentation which I regularly do with hex dumps or all these kind of things. This will be a more general talk about how I look into technical things and how I think somebody can become better as a technical specialist. So it's meant inspirational instead of deeply technical. That doesn't mean that people who are managing technical teams should not listen. I hope this also means you can understand technical people better and even can manage them to become better at what I do. And this is the starting point, and this has been in the interview which I had with Doak too. And it is, whenever I try to do something new, you know, when I'm reading a cool article or a blog post, or I investigate something, which obviously has to do with IT, I need a few takes. Well, if you are pressed for time, it feels like things fall apart in my hands. You know, when you look at blog posts, films, especially films where people are doing a lot of things just by fiddling their fingers on a keyboard, if you see demos in a presentation, etc., it looks like smart kids just do little and reach enormous things without doing a lot. You know, it only takes 2 minutes. It's really easy. You probably recognize these kind of things they say. Well, don't think you're the only one. When I do it and I install something, I have something in my head already, and I try to install it, and it turns out it's the wrong operating system version of the tool or the application for which I want to test. So then I have to delete the virtual machine, create a new one with a different operating system version. Then I try to install it once again, and then it turns out I am missing some libraries, so I have to add libraries, and then I add them, and then I find them in the wrong place. And before you know, there is an hour or even a couple of hours gone on something for which you had in mind for it to only take two minutes. Or if you looked at the presentation when you were looking at an online presentation or joined the presentation in person, you saw somebody do it in 2 minutes. I first thought this was me, but it isn't. And it's kind of obvious, because you can't make the correct decisions if you try to do something new and you don't know what the decisions and the dependencies are. And for that, it really is, you know, I've got two quotes here which are essentially saying the same thing, which is that this failing I'm talking about is somehow important. And I think both of them apply to at least my daily work directly. If you take the quote from Ferdinand Porsche, for example, about failure and challenging yourself, you have to ask yourself, if you do stuff and it just works, where is the fun and where is all the knowledge that you built for doing your work? It would be really boring. And essentially what you're doing is being an operator. And the second one by Thomas Edison looks a bit more abstract. But if you do perform actual engineering, it actually isn't, if you investigate something, then learning what doesn't work is actually truly as important as learning what works. And let me throw in another well-known saying, experience is the accumulation of all known ways to fail. And if this sounds alien to you, please think again. You might even say that it's fundamentally important to fail, because that is when you can distinguish right from wrong. And how can you do that if you're never wrong? So what I'm saying then, am I saying to crash a production database for the sake of learning and fun? Well, obviously not, and of course not. So what I'm saying then is that if you just try to install something, is that if you just do something and it works, you do not learn anything. And this is actually where the difference between a specialist versus an operator comes in. An operator executes a task from a predefined runbook and should not diverge from that, because that could potentially create a unique, unexpected configuration. And that should not happen, because unique configurations are extremely hard to manage, error prone, and hard to automate later on, because all unique features then require exceptions to be programmed in if you try to automate it. And let me tell you, Oracle software itself is that inconsistent in doing things that having more inconsistency adding in does not really help. As a specialist, typically you don't blindly follow a runbook for a given task. If you are supposed to do so, then it doesn't matter that you're a specialist, because you're not allowed to make any changes, and then you perform an operator task. So that means that as a specialist, you perform a more general role, which is to assess a task to be performed, the environment and a machine it should be performed on, and then maybe perform a task with the guidance of a runbook, but you have to adopt it and configure it to a specific environment or to a new version. That means that you have to use your expertise to perform the task. In my opinion, this also means that you should not do it extremely fast, but you should do it meticulously and not that fast. Because if you want to have fast, you first have to create a runbook on how to do it, and then you can do it really fast. So where does the failing part then comes in? Well, if you are performing a specialist task to configure something for a client, obviously the client hopes he hired a good enough specialist not to fail at a given task. However, it is to be able to understand if something works, you have to have the experience in performing the task. And the only way to become a specialist is to actually perform the task and learn from doing it right, and obviously also from doing it wrong. If you only do things right, you will not really learn anything. And more importantly, you will be lost if the inevitable failure happens. And why am I saying inevitable failure? Well, modern software is really complicated, and multiple layers are stacked on top of each other. And actually, from a technical point of view, it's close to a miracle that a lot of stuff really actually does work and performs consistently. And with technology stack and all these technology stacks stacked on top of each other, I do not mean operating system, grid infrastructure, and a database in the case of an Oracle database. But if you look inside the operating system, you see things like networking, which is something independent, the kernel, file.io, etc. And in the Oracle database, you see the same layered approach where different, quite independent teams inside Oracle work on features that somehow magically have to perform together. In short, that means that every now and then you will notice, and everybody who is working with Oracle software for some time will have noticed this, that sometimes things do just not work. And they might even work independently from each other, but not together. And that is because you've got all these stacks which have to work together. And in order to learn that, this is how I do it. And that is, first, rigidly follow the documentation, perform the installation, and in the case of Oracle, set up a certified virtual machine, configure it accordingly to the documentation, and perform the installation. Does that work? And you might say, obviously, but sometimes there are really, really blatantly obvious things missing. In the case of Oracle on Linux, for a long time, this has been the unzip utility, which was not in the pre-install RPM, which is the dependency in which should give you all the dependencies which are needed to install the database software, but it did not include the unzip RPM. and the installation media was shipped. Well, as silly as that sounds, that is technical expertise. I have to say that with recent versions of the pre-install RPM, Unzip is in it, so it's now solved. But this was one of these gotchas where you just had to do it in order to find out that there was an omission. And in case you didn't create a database with the install, which I never do to separate database creation from installation, create a database. And then after you've configured it all, do what I call a parameter test. And that means go through every bit of information that the task gave you, which are typically log files and the documentation, and be familiar where documentation and log files are located, and then go through every one of them and see if there's anything weird. And even if there's nothing weird, you should loosely try to memorize what is in them, so you can, if you do it later on, that you can recognize if it's still the same. And then comes the bit I just said, if there's nothing weird, it's not uncommon to have messages or even failure messages in log files on a completely successful install. And one example of that is that if you install the Oracle database using scripts and you run the data dictionary creation scripts close to the bootstrapping, then the data dictionary creation scripts will first drop every table which it tries to create. And obviously, if you do this for the first time, this table isn't there, but still it will throw an ORA 942, which is table of you does not exist. So that doesn't mean something is not correct. The creators of the script try to be really thoroughly in first dropping it to be absolutely sure that the creation succeeds, but it gives an error message. And this, once again, is knowledge that you build up if you look into these kind of things. But there can be even more drastic issues, even if your setup is totally according to documentation. One of these examples is OPatch, Oracle's patching helper, which you should renew when patching V8's own patch, which is patch 6.880.880. Only the newest version of it can be downloaded from my Oracle support, and it has version numbering once you've downloaded it, but if you have to obtain it, there is only one version, which is the most current version. And sometimes there are bugs or issues with OPatch. Approximately, very roughly every year, I encounter something. And one of these issues, which was, by the way, approximately a year back, was that it couldn't create a directory in the grid home directory when patching. And the lesson learned from that is, if you are rehearsing for a patching, for an Oracle patching cycle, download all the files locally and then use these files instead of the files dynamically downloaded from Oracle once you started performing your whole cycle of, in this case, patching, because only if you've stored the files locally, you can be 100% sure that you're working with the same files at the same time, and therefore can guarantee that if you've rehearsed it in one case, it will be 100% the same in another case. Well, and now that we're at the point of installing, and now comes the most fun part. Once you've installed it in a fully documented way, first try the other documented options as far as doable for you, obviously. If you do not have a rack environment, you cannot test rack or not really test rack. But after you've exhausted the documented options, try things which are not documented. Go to a lower version of the operating system or go to a higher version of the operating system. You might find that it works or it doesn't work, or you might find that you need to install an extra RPM. If you find it doesn't work, use my Oracle support, use Google. Google search is better than my Oracle support. Well, probably everybody knows it by now. And for example, people like Tim Hall from oraclebase.com has done some installing on non-certified version of Linux like Fedora, and test it. Another thing which you might encounter is that sometimes documentation is just wrong. And one example of that is that sometimes the people providing the documentation for patches copy the documentation of an older version and forget to update certain parts. So that is a really fun part, because that's torturing it, pull it apart to silly things. And you will find that the documentation, if you read it, can be anything from really good to really bad. And you have to remember that for the Oracle database, the documentation is created by documentation makers, not the specialists. Obviously, the specialists, the developers of the software, have to provide the information, but it's actual documentation makers who provide the documentation. So it's sometimes there are really silly things. Sometimes there can be really silly things in a documentation. And if you try too high or too low versions of the operating system, you will see that you need to use a flag that's .ignore sys prereq in case of the Oracle Database Installer. And as I said, sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. Or even sometimes you have to set it. For example, if you look at Oracle 19 now being certified on Oracle Linux 8, the installer still checks for only version 7. So if you try to do it, it's now even officially documented that you have to use ignore sys prereq. I think it's sys prereq or sys OS req, something like that, for installing it on a now supported version. Again, try to loosely memorize how the installation looks like, what kind of output do you get, what is in the log files. And if you do it again, this will be of enormous help if you get a request from a client and something doesn't work, because then you can look into the log files and you roughly know what should be there or what messages should be there, and you can start looking for them. And that is that is being a specialist. That is what you do as a specialist. But it doesn't stop there. Try to build an understanding of which messages are shown, what I tell, and where they are. And this requires investigations, searching via Google and my Oracle support. But don't forget talking to specialists and colleagues. Filling a service request with Oracle for an explanation. And this is actually where going to conferences can be a huge aid. You can talk to people who specialized in the topic, or you can walk up to, if the persons are there from Oracle, and ask them how to do stuff. And there are quite some people, and I know a lot of people who are perfectly willing to help you. If you have a specialist, if you want to do a specific setup and you didn't find anything in the documentation and on my Oracle support, and you have a valid case, you have a sensible case, then they are perfectly willing, most of them are perfectly willing to help you. And don't forget, you can be part of this community too. If you found something and solved it, or somebody helped you to solve it, blog about it, and maybe even present about it. And don't forget, you can't do this on the spot when you are supposed to be performing as a specialist. You have to build up that knowledge, and then only then you can become a specialist. However, there is also another side to this. You can't make, in the case of the Oracle database suffer from all the issues that you can potentially run into. So, if you are performing in a specialist role, you might find new issues when investigating an issue with a client. However, with the knowledge you build up, you should be able to get an idea in which area you have to investigate. You should have an idea in which log file to look, and even to categorize where it in which area it roughly is. And once you've diagnosed it, you might recognize the issue via a message in a log file, or even as fluid as time spent in a certain wait. And once you've recognized it, the next step is trying to understand why it's happening. And only once you understand where an issue fits in, and if you understand what the general way a product like the Oracle database is supposed to be working, you should be able to come up with workarounds of real working solutions. And this truly can be hard at times, because especially as a specialist, sometimes you have to dig deeper than what is actually in the documentation and get some understanding of the internal workings. But it's my belief that this is a fundamentally important thing. And this is actually the reason that I do present the technical presentations that I do, in order for people to pick up this and work out stuff on their own, in their own areas, based upon that. And there is another really important thing which should be said, and this is things change. And modern environments are updated at a certain pace. And if you look at it from the correct angle, this is actually everything in an environment. It might not look like it. Things might look really, really static, but at different paces, everything in a modern environment changes. Applications, the database, and the operating system are probably updated with security updates, which have a pace of 1 to 4 times a year. The database and the operating system versions might be updated roughly every 3 to 5 years. If you're lucky, and if you're unlucky, maybe at a higher pace. Server hardware is roughly updated every 3 to 5 years too. And mostly from what I've seen, central storage has a slower cycle, and that's 5 to 10 years. In other words, even if you think I'm mastering my environment and I totally know how it looks like, are you absolutely sure that it still will look like the same in 5 years time? Because it all has been patched, probably. In today's world of security breaches, and things might just gone a bit differently, and that doesn't mean that you shouldn't investigate and become specialized at it. It's the case that you should. So if you see something different, you can roughly understand in which area it is, because you're the specialist and you've investigated this before, and then can dive into it and get an understanding of what's changed. So that means with new versions, you have to revise your knowledge. A new version might partially invalidate your knowledge. And this is kind of a special area, because it's my profound idea that fundamentals do not really change, but all the specifics and all the implementations of these fundamentals really, really do. And once you understand fundamentals better, then it's easier to get an understanding of the specifics which are built upon these chains. And some of these fundamentals are disk layouts, network, and network I/O. And if you don't understand the fundamental things of how things work, you might be sticking to certain settings and configuration that do not make sense, and actually to the specialists will reveal a lack of understanding. And one example of outdated knowledge is an issue of which is an issue of the past, but that's what I'm talking about. An example is 32-bit file systems. A long time ago, processors were predominantly 32 bits, and so were the operating systems running on it, and obviously so were the file systems that operating system supported. And examples of these were AEX, Solaris, HPUX. These all were 32 bit. By having 32 bit file system, it meant that the maximum theoretical file size was 2 to the power of 32, which is 4 gigabytes, which is quite often a large file limit would be 2 gigabytes. And at that time, it mostly wasn't an issue, because database sizes at that time were measured in megabytes. Now, fast forward to somewhere around 2015, and I was asked to join an investigation in a performance issue with a data warehouse. I've forgotten the operating system type, but it was a 64-bit operating system and a 64-bit file system. And it turned out a significant portion of the time was spent in the wait event disk file operations IO. Looking at the number of data files for the table space which was in use, it turned out there were hundreds of data files. And upon asking, the DBA told me that this was because of the file system would not allow files up to, would only allow files up to 2 gig. And when I contacted the sysadmin, he told me this was because of really bad experiences with Oracle files larger than 2 gigabyte. And some operating systems, after process has gone 64-bit, and the operating system gone 64-bit, and the Oracle database software gone 64-bit, needed a flag specified during file system creation to allow files larger than 2 gig. If this wasn't set, it would only allow files to grow to 2 gig and then stop, which would indeed crash Oracle, leaving the file in a broken state. But currently, all modern operating systems and file systems support operating systems do support large files out of the box, and limiting files to 2 gigabytes is silly in today's world, especially for databases where lots of space is used, like data warehouses. The reason for spending lots of time on disk file operations IO was the server process was busy obtaining all the file handles for all the data files. And because of the high number, it simply took a lot of time because this is done serially. And since all current Oracle supported operating systems support large files on file systems, this was totally unnecessary. So the moral of this story is, please do understand when you find an issue, and especially why this is happening. So when the world moves forward and things improve, you can let a restriction go and make life easy for everybody. Another example is data and index table spaces. The very first database that I administered had six disks, unprotected and standalone mount points. I think this was a fairly common setup at the time, although I did not have exposure to a lot of different databases at the time. It had two 300 megabyte disks, two 600 megabyte disks, and two enormous disks of 900 megabytes. And at that time, I've never seen such huge disks of 900 megabytes. Later, I studied the Oracle database and IO, and I learned that the way the vendor set up this machine was default for such a configuration at the time, and setting up data and index on different disks in different table spaces actually made sense. It is common, as we know, for OLTP-like queries to first scan an index and then do a table lookup by an index row ID. By separating table and indexes and placing the data files each on its own disk, you could steer IOs to two separate disks, making the server sort of parallelize IOs if multiple processes used the index lookups. Later, RAID got in common, which roughly speaking, because of the different possibilities for RAID, made it possible to spread IOs over all disks without the need to carefully place data files on specific disks. It was that important for performance to have such a setup that Oracle gave it the name of their own, SAME, same, Stripe and Mirror Everything. Now, fast forward to Oracle 10, and Oracle even created its own Stripe over all disk solutions called ASM. However, having separate data and index table spaces lasted a really long time because lots of DBAs felt it was a concise thing to do. And by doing it, it showed that you carefully administer the database. I hope you all know that now, generally speaking, placing schema objects in their own separate table spaces, which all at the end are on the same set of disks, doesn't make sense because that's micromanagement and it just costs a lot of time. I just place a complete schema in its own big file table space nowadays for an application. So again, the message is there was a best practice. And in this case, it made it possible to leverage the typical common configuration, which was individual disks. But since striping and RAID, that function actually got lost. So it doesn't make sense to spread data and index. And of course, somebody probably can find a reason for it. But in general, if you want to have If you want to spend as little time on it managing it, just use a Stripe set and use a single table space and place everything in it. Having said that, nobody knows everything. And of course, we all know this, but realize that with technologies like the Oracle Database, there is so much terrain that you can study that you very likely need to make choices. Well, and everybody does. You can only study so much. So pick an area that you like and hopefully already have a background in. And make sure that you like it. It's really important that you like it because that keeps you hungry for learning more. Another thing that's really important is never leave the big picture out of your sight. So that means that your expertise actually needs to add concrete business value, not something you really like, but nobody else gains profit from. On the other side of the spectrum is stuff that you don't know. And this is perfectly reasonable. Yet people have a hard time saying that and acknowledging that they don't know something. But I think it's very important to understand what you don't know. In fact, maybe this sounds weird, I consider it a feature of seniority to understand that you don't know things. And actually, when I interview people, I always try to see where the point is, where knowledge of a person stops and where when a person don't know things. And if they understand that they don't know how things truly work and see if they can say it. Because if you can communicate that you don't know something, that is the actually starting point of where you learn something. Just saying that you know it all, people will not try to explain or try to tell you how it works. So that is really important. And nobody can know it all. So that is what I try to do here. Another thing that everybody administering Oracle databases for really any technology for that matter will be affected by it in IT technology is trends. A current trend is cloud. Well, that's everybody must have seen it. A big advance that cloud gives is cloud elasticity. Elasticity means the degree to which a system is able to adapt to workload changes. And if you've ever sat in a sales meeting, you will be given the example of how cloud-native companies like Netflix can very precisely scale to client demands using cloud, and therefore save enormous amounts of memory, because when the demand lowers, it can scale down because of this cloud elasticity. And your on-premises services are not elastic, so you waste a lot of CPU cycles because you have to size for the maximum amount you want to use. And now the understanding bit comes in. To take advantage of a technology, you have to have an architecture that supports that technology. Otherwise, the advance is wasted. Examples of cloud elasticity are designed to be able to take advantage of the ability to use processing power of stateless virtual machines, which indeed can be spun up and taken down as the load requires. Now take a look at the Oracle database. The Oracle database is a monolithic application that runs in the single virtual machine. It can be made to run on virtual machines, that's rack, but that requires reconfiguration and joining a stateful cluster and shared storage, which is not feasible for a cloud. And in general, it's not even certified to run it in the cloud outside of Oracle's own rack cloud offering. In other words, the typical cloud elasticity of scaling via adding and removing virtual machines doesn't work. Of course, you probably can do some scaling by adding CPU and memory, but that was not really the premise of cloud. And in my opinion, this is perfectly fine. The Oracle database is technology that is built in a certain way with certain assumptions. And you have to carefully assess if another architecture is fully compatible with it. What I try to say here is, no technology fits everywhere. So once again, by first understanding how technology works, like the Oracle database, you will see if you can take intrinsic advantage of a new technology, you might find that certain new technologies do not provide the benefit you had hoped for, like, for example, unlimited scalability of the cloud. Having said that, there are a lot of really creative projects that use newer technology and sometimes touch an area like the Oracle database, which are not a native fit for cloud. I just talked about how one of the prominent features of cloud, elasticity, does not fit for the Oracle database. But cloud has other properties that might help with using products like Oracle. One of these properties is the ability to use to store large amounts of data at low cost, which makes it easy for companies to provide something that is independent on that. Another thing that I use a lot is a technology called Vagrant, which automates virtual machine creation for VirtualBox, for example, and provides a cloud-based virtual machine repository. That means that I can have a virtual machine with a certain version of the operating system running in minutes. You might think that it sounds a bit lame, but using the cloud as a virtual as storage for virtual machines images and having saves me enormous amounts of time. Together with another technology to provide version control, Git, in the cloud, using, for example, GitLab or GitHub, in which I store my Oracle installation scripts, I can perform an Oracle installation and database creation in under an hour using the cloud. This means that cloud still is beneficial, but not in the sense of using the Oracle database in a Netflix scalable way. There is another clear trend which seems to be part of the cloud wave of technologies, which I think is fundamentally important for Oracle database specialists, but not only for specialists, but for everybody in IT. And that is automation. Automation for me is a fundamentally important concept that not rigidly, that means that if you're not rigidly applying automation today, you are very likely doing it wrong. Humans are really bad at following a list of tasks to do, and increasingly bad if this task is long, and even more increasingly bad if the executor does not have a profound understanding of what's being done. So, and once again, and everybody who's working with Oracle database, which are probably a lot of people that are listening do, if you have to patch your database, it's probably not during daytime, but during nighttime. So if you have this really long list, or you use offshore to apply it, and the people executing this runbook do not have a really good understanding, then doing it in non-working hours, for example, at midnight, means that it's perfectly possible that it's something goes wrong, or people just skip things. And that's not because people are bad at it or want to make it do wrong, but if there is too many tasks, it simply is hard to comprehend. So in my opinion, really anything that is repetitive should be automated. And lots of database work is repetitive. Operating system preparation for Oracle, data, Oracle Home installation, Oracle Home patching, Oracle database patching, database removal, Oracle Home removal, etc., etc. Machine readiness assessment, machine information retrieval, database information retrieval, monitoring, agent assessment, etc., etc. And now with cloud and infrastructure as a service, you get familiar building blocks, and it's perfectly possible to install the Oracle database software and run it on and run a database. But there sometimes are technologies which are totally not a fit for the traditional technologies like the Oracle database. And one of these examples is Chaos Monkey. And this is not to talk Chaos Monkey down, but it's just too alien for how an Oracle database is supposed to work and can only work because of its technical properties. Chaos Monkey is built by Netflix, and it pretty much does what the name suggests. It causes chaos, and it does it by randomly shutting down virtual machines to test and make sure that everything is resilient to instance failures. And I guess you understand where I'm going here now. If you have stateless virtual machines running your applications in the Netflix way, you can test your resiliency with probably less than 1% of your application server footprint going down. And that's not a problem. But if you are doing this on a database environment where a single machine or maybe two virtual machines are actually the entire layer of an application, then shutting a virtual machine randomly down means 100% of that application is down. Therefore, the entire application will be down. And that simply doesn't work. In fact, I've seen a lot of environments where I did wonder that if somebody would randomly kill a server, if they would not simply go bankrupt, because nobody truly understands how it all fits together and how to make it up and running again, especially if the machine got crashed and you have to recreate it. And that leaves something to think about. So what I'm saying is, it's really important to test and break stuff. The more you made it fail when testing, the better you should be able to respond to it if the unfortunate happens in production and in reality. You have to learn, and it's a good thing to specialize, preferably in something you like, which makes it easier to spend a lot of time on it, breaking and learning about it. Always look into new technologies, but be aware that not all might apply to the technology we are working with, and in my case, the Oracle database. Even if the vendor pushes really hard, that doesn't mean you should not look into it, like I tried describing. I think cloud, despite not being a native fit for an Oracle database, at least for me, transformed a lot of what I do. And probably this is true for a lot of other people too. So be creative and be yourself, and look at the creativity of others. Learn from them too. And in one way or another, things change and will change. Be prepared to accept it and consider it to be a constant for learning. That was my presentation. Are there any questions?
Okay, Fritz, thanks very much for your inspiring lecture. That gives us something to think about. I think every one of us has experienced similar situations. Yeah. Let me check if there are any questions.
No, I don't see any.
Not for the moment.
No. Well, in case there is some.
Yeah. If anybody wants to ask Fritz something, please type in your questions.
And you can also email them. Let me put my email on, or you can send it via Twitter, yeah, or LinkedIn. And I think a lot of people will know how to find me. And otherwise, you just type in my name in Google, and probably one page or another comes up where something like this will be on it. So yes, hopefully this inspired people and also gave them something to think about, and put the enormous pressure of cloud to think about where it fits in. So I hope it was inspirational, and thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Fritz.